Today's curiosity is assisted by Jarpur Amber Ale from Brazen Hole Brewing in Winnipeg. This is one of the beers that they've had consistently available since the place opened. As they describe it, deep in color, rich in flavor. Not much else to say. I've had it many times and I like it. Today I'm taking a look at this unit here that I've had for, 20, 30 years maybe? This is the cold heat soldering iron. Yes, that is a bit of an oxymoron. Oof. Ah, haven't had this out of the case for a while. That rubbery kind of stuff on there is sticky. And the reason I haven't had it out of my case in all these years is it turned out to be less than average quality for as seen on TV product. Essentially what it is a resistant soldering device that is handheld and battery powered. And resistant soldering works basically by passing current through a carbon rod tip through the workpiece and then back in again, and right at that contact point generates a tremendous amount of heat because, you know, there's a lot of current going through a very small area and it heats up enough to solder. And resistant soldering in and of itself is not a bad thing and not a scam or anything else. It's commonly done for guys that build brass locomotives and models like that. This one, however, is powered by a couple of batteries and it just could not generate the heat to do that very well. Plus, as you can see, the sharp bit of the tip broke off pretty easily. I only used this a handful of times, and each time I was quite disappointed. And also each time I had to replace the batteries because, like I said, it just chews through batteries. According to Wikipedia, the tip is not just your standard carbon rod like is normally used for resistant soldering. It is made out of some sort of proprietary compound that they gave a fancy name to, but fancy name aside, it is basically just a pair of carbon rods in a little form factor up front here. The novel thing about it, as I said, where it's a soldering iron powered by common alkaline batteries. They claim it can get up to 427 Celsius within 3 seconds and then cool right back down again. Yeah, sure, it cooled down quickly, I guess, but it had trouble generating enough heat for me to use properly. And one telling thing is, in this Wikipedia article, the longest single section in the article is the criticism section. So according to my searching, this thing was originally applied for a patent back in May of 2005. And as you can see in the Wikipedia article, they sold licensing at the end of 2005 to Weller, a Cooper, who sold it apparently as a Cold Heat Pro. This one's not branded as that though. This is the original one that they were selling through as seen on TV ads. But that aside, let's just see if this thing will sort of work any better or worse than it did decades and decades ago when I tried to use it. Two double A's by the looks of it. That stickiness. Oh no, not two. Looks like it'll fit four in there. Yeah, okay. So, still, with just four double A's, yes, I know that ribbon's not in the right spot. With four double A's, you're never going to get enough current to create a lot of heat for an extended period of time, are you? And the original reason that I got this thing all those years ago was for soldering joiners on model railway track. So let's see if we can accomplish that at all. We'll use a sort of medium gauge solder to give it a bit of a chance. So apparently what you do, or what I remember you do, is you turn on the switch there, and then when there's an electrical contact across the tip, that LED should light up. And it's not even doing that. So yeah, it's been a long time since I've had this thing out of its box, and that's the reason why. Not that it matters, because I wasn't planning on using it anyway. I just came across it when I was tidying up around here. Don't act so shocked. I do tidy up occasionally. But since it obviously doesn't want to work, let's take it apart. That's the real reason that this video exists. So after taking the battery cover off, it reveals a couple of screws there. Another one up here. Come in. And I can see another one back in there. I guess that's probably just holding on this sticky bit back there, so we'll get that out. Yes, that's exactly what it did. Okay. Oh, and there's some more screws hiding underneath that. Not a horrible case design, I guess. Come on. Okay. Oh, yeah. And the tip is replaceable. It just slides out like that. You could buy more of them from the company if you chose to. Down inside there, you can see the two electrical contacts, one going to each side of the little carbon or graphite, or what do they call it, athelite tip here. There's a little cover for the switch. There's an LED there, and I think if I got all the screws out of it, it should just come apart like that. I felt something hit my ankle. Hang on for a second. Nothing important. It was just a nut that was held in. Okay, so there's nothing on that side. This side has a little circuit board at the back here, behind the batteries. And we have the power switch up here. We have the LED up there. We have another LED, little headlight illuminator one down there. And then that is just the holder for the magic tip. So I guess the intelligence happens back here. So will that just lift out? Okay, so that's just the battery clip. And that just lifts out. And then how are the wires held in there? Looks like they're just kind of heat staked in. So can I clip off that little holder bit without destroying the wires? Not that I'm particularly bothered if I do destroy them, but let's just get this out of here. Only broken one wire so far. And this little amalgamation of stuff up here is held in by a couple more screws that I didn't notice earlier. And that all comes out, and I pry the battery clips out. There we go. There's all of it out. So without even doing a schematic, it looks like the power goes from one end of the battery through the power switch to one of the two terminals of the tip, and the other terminal of the tip is connected to the other end of the batteries. So there is no switching mechanism other than, you know, that power switch. There is no control mechanism for this tip. It just raw dogs the 6 volts out of the AA cells straight through this and through the load. So if that stopped working, it was either battery connections, but they don't look like they're corroded or anything. Now they all look pretty clean. Maybe that connection in there? Oops, come on out of there. How does that go in there? That just slides in like that. So maybe the connection between those little wipers and this thing has gone bogus, or like I said, I don't really care because it never worked well even when it was working. It never seemed to transfer the heat properly. But what are the other questions we have here? So there's positive and negative coming from the batteries or from the switched batteries. And there are a positive and negative going to the LEDs. So total of 4 wires on this thing. So did it just turn on the LEDs? Really? Let's look a bit closer at this board. I don't think we're going to get any intelligence out of that chip because, of course, Ooh, secrets. They have. Looks like they took a Dremel to the top of it or something to hide their secrets. Wow. Other than that, we got, you know, capacitor, resistor, transistor, resistor, resistor. And on the back side, just six more resistors and a diode. Two diodes. So just jumping around the traces through vias and whatnot, it looks like that little transistor there, which is a J6, so just a basic little NPN, that transistor is connected to one of the wires going to this LED. So that's all it did is turn that on. And of course, there's no knowing exactly what that chip is doing, although one of its pins does go to that. So maybe it just senses for a voltage drop. It doesn't have access to a current measurement at all. So yeah, maybe it just is monitoring the batteries or something. I don't know. It also seems to turn that on as well. Does it turn them both on together? Hang on. Oh, that other LED appears to be getting its power from whatever is on the other side of that via, which is, of course, hidden under the chip. And without knowing what that chip is, it really doesn't matter all that much. I'm still amazed that they went to the effort of grinding away at the surface of that chip rather than just obliterating it with epoxy or chemically or something like that. The fact that somebody actually took the effort to do that to every one of those chips manually, presumably with a Dremel or some other tool, suggests that these ones, at least in the era that this one was made, were not built in the highest of volumes. Now, there's not that much more to say about this thing. It's disappointing that it didn't work as promised way back when, because, like I said, resistance soldering is a valid thing, and it is used for people that make brass models on a regular basis. That was a really quick video. I only had a couple of sips out of my beer while I was making it. So do any of you other old-timers remember this thing when it was showing up on As Seen in TV ads or when it was in Radio Shack? Did you have one? Did it work any better than mine? Or did you have the same experience as the complaints and controversies section of the Wikipedia article showed? Let me know down in the comments below. But anyway, yeah, that's it for now. Quick, not too rambly, and yeah, this thing will remain in pieces because I have no intention of using it again. Thanks for watching. As I said, questions or comments down below. I will talk to you later.